Bon dia, us dono la benvinguda a la jornada Empoderament Femení i Política Democràtica, una jornada que organitza la Fundació Copieters, Copieters Foundation. Tinc aquí al costat a Xavier Macias, que n'és el president, i la Fundació Josep Irla. Esperem que siguin unes hores molt interessants, molt enriquidores i molt empoderadores per les dones. Avui aquí pensem en la millor manera de ser societat i de fer política. Fer política consisteix a prendre decisions sobre el que és comú. Avui parlem de dones que prenen decisions i democràcia. I en parlem perquè el món de la política, ja ho sabem, que ha estat tradicionalment un món masculí. Els homes hi han tingut un protagonisme molt gran, mentre que les dones no hi han pogut accedir amb tanta facilitat, sinó que han tingut un paper més secundari. Aquesta desigualtat estructural té conseqüències que es poden sentir en la manera de viure, tant a casa nostra com arreu del món. Quins motius hi ha darrere d'aquest fet? Està canviant aquesta realitat o és encara vigent avui dia? Per quan en tenim? Que hem de pensar que a casa nostra, fins al 1976, les dones estaven catalogades al grup de menors i incapacitats i ni tan sols podíem treballar sense el consentiment del pare o del marit. Malgrat que amb el temps s'ha anat aconseguint una igualtat d'oportunitats legal entre homes i dones, encara existeix la desigualtat real. Per molt preparades professionalment que estiguem les dones, estem poc representades en els òrgans de direcció de tota mena. I en política, com a la resta de la societat, les dones són més a la base. A mesura que la piràmide del poder s'estreny a les posicions superiors, escassegem més i més respecte a l'altre sexe. Les dones, ho sabem, troben límits invisibles per accedir a llocs de lideratge que fan que les posicions i, per tant, la influència en les decisions no s'arribin a equiparar ni de lluny a les dels homes. Hi ha inèrcies velles, hi ha perjudicis instal·lats, moltes d'elles són a l'àmbit domèstic i d'altres a la vida pública. I plegades, sumades, unes i altres, fan que, malgrat que els obstacles no siguin explícits, sí que hi siguin obstacles per la igual representació. Què passarà en els propers anys? Podem ser optimistes a mitjà termini, llarg termini? Malgrat ser, com dèiem, no?, un món majoritàriament masculí, sembla que cada vegada hi ha més dones que lideren partits, que lideren institucions i que planten cara a les injustícies i els tics del passat. Sembla que cada vegada hi ha més dones que passen a l'acció, que prenen consciència que cal passar a l'acció, concretament a l'acció política. I també sembla que hi ha més dones i més homes també que ho van compartint. Una demostració és la celebració avui d'aquesta mateixa jornada que ens fa convergir per pensar junts sobre tot això. Per fer-ho, per aprofundir en la realitat tal com és i per pensar en la manera de fer passos més ferms i més llargs fins a l'objectiu, que ara encara és a l'horitzó, aquest horitzó de la plena igualtat real, comptem amb dones avui aquí amb un bagatge, una formació i una credibilitat més que notables, perquè ens acompanyaran la Judit Vega, la Sílvia Claveria, la Jill Evans, l'Anna Miranda i l'Esther Capella. Després de la intervenció del Xavier Macias, la Judit Vega farà la conferència titulada Empoderament femení i llibertat republicana. A continuació, la Sílvia Claveria presentarà l'estudi sobre la presència de les dones al poder executiu i després ens trobarem per parlar informalment tot fent el cafè per, després del descans, continuar amb la taula rodona que compartiran la Jill Evans, l'Anna Miranda, la Sílvia Claveria i la Judit Vega. I la consellera de Justícia, l'Esther Capella, clourà la jornada. Per tant, un luxe, no? I agraïm molt a totes que hi participin. Per tant, com que creiem fermament que una societat democràtica no es pot considerar veritablement com a tal si deixa fora de l'exercici del poder polític una part de la ciutadania, pensem que l'empoderament polític femení és imprescindible perquè la democràcia ho sigui de debò i no només formalment. Volem una agenda de tothom i per tothom. I per això hi ha de tenir veu tothom, i si em permeteu la picada d'ullet lingüística bromística, tot don. De manera que desitgem que aquesta sigui una jornada que contribueixi a fer-ho possible. I aquí dono la paraula al Xavier Macias, president de la Fundació Copieters.
Bon dia, moltes gràcies. Benvinguts i benvingudes en nombre també de la Fundación Copieters, a estas jornadas que coorganizamos con uno de nuestros socios más importantes, más solventes, de las 16 organizaciones que estamos asociadas en la Fundación Copieters. Es uno de los socios fundadores, la Fundación Josep Irla, de esta organización, la Copieters, que nació hace 12 años. Yo he participado ya en otras jornadas de esta cita anual de la Fundación Copieters, de esta rigurosa cita anual que va tratando muy diversos temas de interés, y en los últimos años no había podido estar por cuestiones fundamentalmente laborales, y hoy estoy doblemente contento por poder participar en estas jornadas. En primer lugar, porque es la primera vez que estoy en Barcelona, en Cataluña, después de la sentencia del proceso, y me apetecía, y estoy contento por poder expresar aquí personalmente la solidaridad que procuramos también expresar siempre que tenemos actos de la Fundación Copieters, también por Europa Adelante, ¿no? Eso me hace recordar que hace años también compartí una de estas inauguraciones con Oriol Junqueras y también a los pocos días de entregar nuestro premio anual, que es nuestro premio Copieters, que este año le hemos dado a Camilo Nogueira, un líder histórico del nacionalismo galego, y a Pachi Zabaleta, un líder histórico del movimiento Adversale. Pues recordar que hace dos años le dimos el premio a Carme Forcadell, que de aquella era presidenta del Parlamento de Cataluña, y que la última vez que la pude saludar tuve que hacerlo separada de ella por un vidrio, no pudimos ni siquiera estrecharnos la mano, y es ese vidrio y esos muros que la separan a ella, a todos los demás presos políticos y probablemente a todos nosotros de la democracia. La segunda razón por la que estoy satisfecho de estar hoy aquí es por el tema de las jornadas. Y aunque sea, disculparme que hable un poco de mí mismo, pero yo pertenezco a una generación de hombres militantes y activistas demócratas que nos pretendíamos revolucionarios y yo creo que éramos en realidad demócratas, y eso en el Estado español es mucho ser. Pues una generación de gente que en la segunda mitad de los años 70 tuvimos la suerte de tomar contacto con el feminismo. Y eso, de alguna manera, nos marcó a una serie de gente para bien. En estos 40 años pudimos ver los avances de los derechos de las mujeres y desde hace ya, lamentablemente, también algunos años estamos viendo una ofensiva reaccionaria, una contraofensiva reaccionaria que está intentando recortar esos mismos, pocos aún, pero esos mismos derechos. En fin, desde el punto de vista de la Fundación Copieters, deciros que, como en tantas otras organizaciones, tardamos mucho en ser consecuentes con la lucha por la igualdad. Y solo en los últimos 4 o 5 años tomamos medidas normativas, medidas estratégicas, que puedan garantizar que realmente contribuimos de manera efectiva, en la medida de nuestros medios, al progreso de la igualdad de las mujeres, ¿no? Y solo desde que tomamos esas medidas, y enfatizo esto porque supongo que sean cosas de las que se hablará hoy, a partir de tomar medidas concretas, hemos conseguido empezar a tener cierta equidad en la presencia de mujeres, en nuestros trabajos, en nuestras actividades, en nuestras investigaciones. Ahora procuramos tener ese porcentaje mínimo y el resultado fue un salto cualitativo, aunque seguimos teniendo grandes deficiencias porque el mínimo despiste supone un retroceso y tenemos, lamentablemente, despistes de vez en cuando. En fin, procuraremos seguir contribuyendo en la medida de nuestras posibilidades a hacer frente a la ofensiva machista y a contribuir a garantizar los avances de la igualdad de las mujeres, en lo que yo por lo menos considero que es la auténtica revolución de nuestra época, no hay otra. Yo creo que la revolución que protagonizáis las mujeres y que procuramos acompañar a algunos hombres es la revolución que vamos a vivir, en el tiempo que vamos a vivir, no solo nosotros, sino alguna de la gente que aún vendrá después, ¿no? Entonces, por eso considero que jornadas como las de hoy son muy importantes, porque además ponen el acento en una de las realidades que aún se escapan, digamos, al avance real de las mujeres, que son las esferas del poder real, ¿no? Hoy se hablará del poder, los ejecutivos, los gobiernos, ya no digamos nada en el poder de las empresas, ¿no? Y yo creo que por algo será que ahí es donde cuesta más que las mujeres tengáis protagonismo. Bien, sin más, le voy a dar la palabra a nuestra primera conferenciante, que es Judith Vega. Trabaja como profesora de Filosofía Social y Política en la Universidad de Groningen, en los Países Bajos. Sus investigaciones abordan, en general, la mezcla de la política y la cultura a lo largo de la historia de la modernidad. Ha publicado, entre otras cosas, sobre la historia de las ideas políticas, la naturaleza de la filosofía republicana, la justicia de reconocimiento y la ciudadanía cultural. La filosofía feminista es un ángulo prominente en su investigación. Tenemos la suerte de poder escucharla y le doy la palabra. Muchas gracias.
I'm very grateful to be invited to this event. It's a great opportunity to talk with so many people, diverse people, about women and democracy. I'm a philosopher and I will talk today about Republican philosophy. That is a long-standing tradition of political philosophy, of talking about politics and democracy. It has been with us for about 2,500 years. Let me stipulate one thing before I continue, because sometimes there's a bit of a confusion here. The word republicanism nowadays is being used in ways that have little to do with this philosophical tradition. Of course, we know the word from the American Republican Party that has little or no relation to the tradition I'm going to talk about. But even, for example, French political republicanism has little, or let me say, strange relation to that tradition. So my topic will be the ideas on republican politics from a very long tradition, and more precisely, of course, the relevance to feminism of that very tradition. I think the republican language of talking about politics has a specific relevance to feminist movements, to feminist concerns, and I hope to illustrate some of those points of connection in my presentation. One of the interesting things for me about the republican language of politics and emancipation or empowerment is that it constitutes an alternative to liberal talk about emancipation and empowerment. And I think that is the language we nowadays mostly use for talking about women's emancipation or, for that matter, all emancipation of all sorts of other groups. Liberalism talks about freedom mostly in terms of not being interfered with, being left alone, having increasing amount of choices, mostly in the realm of consumerism, of course, and equality thought of mostly as a juridical category in terms of individual rights. That amounts to an enormous focus on individual presence in politics, and I think republicanism offers alternative ways of thinking empowerment, emancipation and politics. And I think its language dovetails well with concerns that have been articulated in feminist theory and practice. First indication of that is that republicanism resists talking about individuals as some essentialist category of identity. It can be used to resist naturalizing gender categories, which I think is an important feminist concern. Women are not just biological entities they are sometimes supposed to be. So first, it is an anti-naturalizing language, and second, it has a specific idea of what makes us human. And I think that's also important, but I hope to illustrate this in the following. As I said, it's a long-standing philosophical tradition. It started to be articulated during the Greek city-states from ancient times. And it was mostly concerned, as a political theory, with the self-rule of citizens. It is a political theory that is not in the first place about the state, a focus we would have nowadays when we talk about politics, but about what, in actually the Latin words was called the res publica, the public realm. So it's in public realm that people should develop themselves and take care of the stability of the republic, of the equality of the citizens, and the engagement with the good life that politics would have to provide for the citizens. And that involves one important idea on what it means to be human. And we nowadays mostly think about being mostly human when we are in our homes or in our private spheres and have enough money to buy nice stuff. And the Republican tradition very much insists on the fact that we become human through participation in public life, in political life. It's not economic life or private life where we find our human essence, but by participating with our peers in public life. So that's the first point. And it is pretty counterintuitive because we have lost that idea of being human. And that is the fault of liberalism. So ancient philosophy, there it all starts, the res publica and the idea of the self-rule of citizens. This tradition has been taken up through the ages and mostly when in the Enlightenment, again, democracy was an important point of discussion and people started to talk about democracy and about democratic constitutions. And the first way of critiquing actually the new liberal discourse on human rights, on citizen rights, on democracy, was that it tended when it emphasized individual rights and the fact that people's self-interest should be articulated through political organization, it would tend to forget public interest. People were admonished to take care of themselves, to insert their views of their self-interest into politics, but that would forget the fact that we also have a sort of common good that has to be taken care of. Self-interest forgets public interest. Private virtue forgets public virtue. It was a complaint mostly articulated by Benjamin Constant, one of the English commentators on the French Revolution. Later on, this sort of critique of liberalism, of course, got other articulations, and it is still with us. We can even find a republican aspect in Marxism, which of course criticized the capitalist form liberalism would take during the 19th century. And the general complaint is that liberal citizenship, which focuses much on the individual and his or perhaps also her rights, favors individualization and cuts us off from our co-workers, mostly in Marxism it's about work, but our co-workers and also our co-citizens. When we get individualized, we do not see how much our experiences and life forms are embedded in collective forms and in socialized ways of living our lives. In general, republicanism has a thicker concept of citizenship than liberalism has. Liberalism is associated with the concept of the bourgeois. We want to get rich and happy mostly through our economic and private exertions to do for the good life. And the republicanism would say this bourgeois carries the problem of individualizing issues and making individuals responsible for their proper wealth and happiness. And the word citoyen, which is French and cannot really be translated into English because it has one word, same problem in Dutch, by the way, but so I use the French words. The citoyen is actually this republican idea that you have an obligation to engage with your co-citizens in order to make stable and fair communities. This ancient republicanism has been taken up by feminist theory already in various ways. There were some clear problems with the theory that mostly speak to feminism. One is the fact that the focus on public life, at least in the ancient republics, involved depreciation of private life. Private issues should not enter political life because they would form a corruption, one could say, for functioning in public. So there's a strong hierarchy between public life and private life, and this would constitute a problem for feminism, as women still are mostly associated with private life, as it was in the ancient republics, and their concerns would thereby be not a priority for republicanism. It also has a rather heroic idea of civic action. It's about competition in public, who can speak the loudest, who can assert himself mostly as a leader of the group. So these are aspects which feminism would feel uncomfortable with. But there are also various inspirations for feminism from the 18th century, when the republicanism was taken up by women a lot, actually, till today. And that is the fact that it has this political view of identity. Identity is not something you do on your own, but which you can, something that you can only evolve and elaborate within communal situations, within what we call, as philosophers, intersubjective relations. You cannot do freedom on your own. You cannot even do equality on your own. Another inspiration for feminism is the enormous focus of republican theory on equality. Equal public presence is necessary for the republic to function well. And it is the citizens who should be able to establish this equal, this republic based on equality. Another quote term for republicanism is a struggle against corruption. Corrupt citizens cannot benefit the state. And that has been translated a lot from the 18th century onwards, of course, first of all, against corrupt politicians, corrupt monarchies, or aristocrats, and it's still with us. It has been translated in various ways, also to insert a notion of moral action into politics. Politics should be anti-corruption because corruption would undermine public life. There are two important varieties in the 20th century of republicanism, and these are two names that I have mentioned here. Perhaps you have heard of them, perhaps not. One of them is Hannah Arendt, the other one is Philip Pettit. And an important intuition of Arendt's republicanism was her insistence that liberalism has shut us out of the world. It has made us uncomfortable with the world. It turns us to the private sphere, to economic success, to private success. It makes us into consumers mostly, and perhaps laborers, but it has forgotten to make us aware of the public character of politics and of our lives. Republicanism is not so much about mere equal rights, it is mostly about access to participation, creating opportunity for presence outside of private life. So republicanism feels itself responsible to create spaces where individuals can act together in order to, in Hannah Arendt's term, discover themselves, because you cannot discover, according to her, yourself on your own. You do that among other people with whom you speak and interact. So republicanism, according to her, is about allowing individuality to come about on the basis of peer presence. And the interesse, the being between each other, is where freedom and equality will arise. So you need the other for showing the uniqueness of your own individual person. And you only can show that in speaking with other people, where you discover yourself. Speaking is a spontaneous process mostly, even if you prepare a lot, it's still a sort of spontaneous practice. And only there you discover who you are, and others can discover who you are. Okay, so this is the importance of participation has a direct effect also on your own development, your self-development. For Philip Pettit, republicanism is mostly a theory that wants people to fight domination. To being dominated is the worst thing that for a republican citizen could happen. And that's a broad concept, but it's also important because it does not mean that you are free from other people interfering with you, from being bothered by other people, almost to the contrary. You want to be free from domination, but perhaps sometimes you need help with that, from others or from the state. So the struggle against being dominated by others, by being arbitrarily dominated by people or institutions that hinder you in becoming who you are as an individual, as a unique individual, that is the emphasis that republicanism, according to him, should have. Republicanism wants equal individual freedom. In that sense, it can be compared, of course, to liberalism. But that is not a freedom in terms of freedom of choice. It is mostly a freedom that may benefit from intervention when the state hinders violence in the private sphere by criminalizing it, for example. It helps countering dominance in private life. So that there is interference, but that helps freedom to come about. Liberalism has mostly been hesitant about this sort of state intervention, but republicanism has a precise goal with intervention. It should combat domination. So from the French Revolution onwards, in the 18th century, republicanism has been a big inspiration for feminists. Mary Wollstonecraft is probably the most famous name from that era, an English feminist commenting on the French Revolution again. For her, the republican language was actually more important than the language of rights that you see come up. And she was not the only one. Of course, women insisted on their rights already then. It has taken quite a time before we got equal rights, actually, 200 years. But I think when you read the text from the feminist text from that era, you mostly see that women wanted equal public status. They wanted rights, but with a purpose, not just to have their individual choice being extended, for example, but they wanted to be recognized as equal parties in public life, in all sorts of institutions, in labor, in politics, in culture, etc. So there was already a very broad ideal of freedom from domination, an ideal of being allowed an equal public status and not being dominated by others, the state or co-citizens. That broad ideal was already present with us with the very first stages of modern feminism during the French Revolution and other revolutions during that time in Europe and America. We now see a discussion that has, and I know that has probably been broader, but we know it mostly from discussions within France, which has a strong republican state ideology. We see that in France, the idea of republicanism has mostly translated into a state which is neutral and imposes, one could say, equal public presence on all, but translates that in a rather substantial way. It wants a neutral public where difference is abolished because we should be equal citizens and also see each other as such in the public sphere. And you probably know about the ban on the headscarf in France in public institutions such as education, which has been seen as mostly a law on. It's not a law on the headscarf, it's a law on the very clear presence of religious identity in the public sphere. That would not just be the headscarf, but also other things. But it seems mostly to be used against Muslim women who are forbidden the headscarf because that would make their difference in public in the public sphere to clear. This idea of the unity of the public in this sense, imposed from above, you could say, has been called an exclusionary idea rather than a republican idea of equal citizens feeling responsible for a stable society. And Cécile Laborde is an author who has written a lot about this. And she says, we cannot have such a national idea of the republic where we impose one notion of the citizen on the public sphere so as to have a superficial, you could say, equal presence of citizens where their difference is being hidden and actually transported to the private life. You can be religious in the private sphere, but not in public, because then you would not be seen as an equal citizen anymore. So Cécile Laborde says, well, that cannot be the translation of republicanism, especially not for feminists. What republicanism in modern times has to do is to negotiate all these differences between citizens. We have a pluralist society, we have all different religions, or not a religion at all. We cannot simply move these differences to the private sphere, but we have to negotiate these differences and in an effort to establish a solidary public. In her terms, we have to equip individuals with tools to resist domination, but that cannot mean that you disallow the expression of people's specific life stories or convictions. So this problem of national republicanism has also a clear feminist relevance. There are, of course, many feminisms, and there have been many feminisms through the history. This is one way of distinguishing between different feminisms: liberal feminism, radical feminism, and republican feminism. As I said, liberal feminism would translate mostly into a demand for equality. It would insist on the reparation of equal rights if women don't still have equal voice, equal status in legal rights, then this should be repaired so that women get equal status to men. Radical feminism has turned this around. It mostly says, well, this equality of liberalism already presupposes several masculine standards, masculine standards of equality, of presence, of voice. And women's own history, own cultures should be recognized more. We women should be recognized. We have something to contribute to society other than the already existing standards of equality. So you could call this a demand for the recognition of difference. Women in their difference have something to contribute, and this should be recognized by politics and by society at large. Would be identity politics. We women, the group of women, wants recognition in politics and society. I think republican feminism is an alternative to both of these. As Hannah Arendt said, we should not conceive of social groups in natural terms. That is a political danger. When we see blacks, for example, as constituting one group with natural characteristics, then this will lead to racism. She herself was concerned with Jewish history, of course. But I think this also translates towards the history of women. When women are seen as a natural group, biological characteristics, rather than as a group that has been come into existence through social and political work as such. Science, politics have contributed to the definitions of what woman is. If we do not resist that, we will not get free of that sort of essentialist characterizations of what a woman would be. So republican feminism, rather than either liberal feminism or radical feminism, would want attention to the way women have been defined, have been attributed characteristics, and would try to turn these around. It involves a claim not so much merely for equal rights and also not for, again, the assertion of women as a group, but a claim for not being dominated by socially accepted and historically imposed ideas of what womanhood would be. Equality also is not just a matter of equal rights of the law, but it is a very broad issue which is at play also in civil society, in society at large and in the private sphere. So equality cannot be seen merely as a legal category. It's much more difficult, you could say. It's about also us, how we relate to each other in our daily lives, about how our employers react to us, about how our co-workers react to us, etc., etc. Freedom, then, is a non-individualist issue to republican feminism. It is something that has to be constituted collectively, but not on the basis of collective groups that are seen as natural categories. It's not about just women. So identity for republicanism is an interesting but also difficult topic. Republicanism has evidently, as I already indicated, consequences for thinking the nation. Are we one nation? Are we one republic? And what does that mean for minority groups or indeed for women, which is not a minority group? But it has then also consequences for feminist reflection on female identity or gender identity in general, which is then not just women, but also men, of course. And I think republicanism has can take two roads here, and has taken two roads here. And the first is to associate republicanism indeed with communitarianism, as in national republicanism, such as the French variety of it. And of course the French sentence, la République une et indivisible, is telling, it is the republic, it is one, and what is the English here? Well, indivisible, actually. It cannot be divided into groups. We should be one and one collective. And this is a sort of almost a logo of the French state, you could say. It means, it presupposes that as subjects, we are indeed not individual entities. We are embedded in collective identities. We are integrated in historical entities and in cultural surroundings. And from there we speak, and we should be engaged with our political context. So communitarianism would say that there is a community you belong to, and that can be delineated. It has characteristics, histories, cultures, and values. But I already indicated, for example, through Hannah Arendt's variety of republicanism, that republicanism is not so much about insisting on being a community, but about insisting on building community. We are not already a community. We can come about by public action and by feeling responsible for the public welfare. So we are not a community. We will build a public community, a we. I would call this a political take on community rather than a naturalist take on community. You are not French, we are not French, or Catalan, or Dutch, or whatever, wherever we come from. We have to build those communities with an eye to each other's equality and freedom. Subjects come about through public interaction. We are not already there. Only in speaking and acting together, we know who we are and we know who the others are. So we make ourselves through action and speech. We call that also a performative identity. We perform the identity we want to become. So in speaking and dressing and acting, I can make myself into a woman more or less, or I can try to divert that image towards something else. But that's also true for national identities. The Dutch identity to many politicians in the Netherlands seems something self-evident. We have a history, it started somewhere at some revolution or constitution. And we have these cultural values and rituals, and that is what the Dutch identity would be about. But what that story, of course, forgets is the enormous amount of work that gets into constituting such identities. You can construe the Dutch identity in many ways and have it start in many different historical places it can be ascribed very different sorts of values, and that's again true for any and all national identities in the world. They are made into by a lot of work, scientists, journalists, historians, politicians. Our identities are imagined, that is one of the words that literature uses here. We imagine being Dutch, we imagine being Catalan, we imagine being Spanish. Our traditions are invented. We retell them, we work on them, we make their stories into novels and in scientific literature, in political statements. They are not, they become. And also, the same goes for gender identity. Women are not something. They are mostly made into something, which is precisely the problem, which made them not eligible for equal rights in the first place. So this ascription of identity, both to nations and to genders, is precisely the problem feminism has to deal with. And the important thing, I think, for feminism is to keep being aware how much of work goes into the awareness and expression of identity, also our own. Yes, okay, sorry, I'll go on to one. So this, a Republican public life nowadays. We cannot, of course, simply stay at the city-states from ancient times, nor at the times of the French Revolution. I think that there are two issues that modern republicanism needs to address, which were neither very high on the agenda in the ancient city-states nor the French Revolution. Those are economy and globalization, of course, and these are new issues for a republican language. Republicanism talks a lot about politics, but it does not talk much about economic inequality. So this is an issue for modern times, because economic inequality is also an important issue for feminism, given the fact that women still earn much less than men overall. But it's not just about income disparities or financial disparities. We also need to talk about the organization of work. How do you organize work? Who gets voice? Who gets hierarchically rewarded for their actions? Same issue, globalization, migration. You see that in many discussions and also legal translations of asylum, for example, that the typical migrant is a man, and concerns for women are not truly addressed in being eligible for asylum. One very important issue, of course, is the matter of sexual violence, which is only with difficulty recognized as a claim in itself for asylum. And I think this, of course, would fall under the Republican insistence on a life free from dominance, very clearly. So, gender. Already Wollstonecraft, in 1792, during the French Revolution, wrote that the sexual distinction is arbitrary. This is a very early intuition of feminism. Men and women are not there. It's an arbitrary distinction. It's made up of historical stories, of political stories, of practices, of cultural values, etc. Gender in modernity, philosophers then also say, is fundamentally contested. Feminism is an important contester, but also right-wing populism in Europe, for example. So this fact that we do not really know who women are, although we can tell many stories about it, and the same goes for men, actually, but women are less visible in their diversity, I would say, than men. This is a problem for feminism as a woman's movement. How do we constitute solidarity? But being a woman is hardly enough for the claim to solidary action. We can talk perhaps that later. But something that we have to think about. And perhaps one thing that I would like to address is the fact that, at least in the Netherlands, but probably here too, diversity is really the jargon for institutions to talk about feminism. We need diverse institutions. Universities need diversity in their job advertisements. We want women in, we want people from other cultures in. And this sounds very nice, but I get increasingly annoyed by it because it seems very empty. It says again that all these identities should enter a university or labor organizations, or industries, whatever, on the basis of these natural identities, which is actually pretty problematic, because then we will have women in the organization, we will have a certain percentage of our minorities, in the Dutch case that would, for example, be Moroccans, and so on and so on. So these people get in because of a naturalist category to which they perhaps do not feel they belong, or what would it mean to which they belong. So we should, as Republicans, insist on the individual quality of identity given the fact of the ascribed collective identities. And this is a very complex situation, of course, because I do want a sort of diverse, I do want women to have jobs. That's, of course, a very important feminist demand. But it is also very problematic in all sorts of respects. So I would say that difference or diversity obscures provenance. It obscures people's very individual life histories, individual attachments and convictions. The problem should not be having diversity in our flagging, so to say, our institutions. But we should take care of having dominance-sensitive institutions and develop a language to talk about that. So this is my last slide. Women's empowerment, which was my topic, our topic, would benefit from these bullets, I think. First of all, the insistence on rights and economic success hinders something like cooperative life, which needs different orientations, different values. Feminism is about construing new identities, and that means it cannot be just about more women in boards, although that's very important. We will hear a presentation of a report that, soon. I think it is rather about creating new men and women, because, again, the more women is, in various respects, I think, problematic, if even because it's bad for women, because they are then targeted as you only got a job because you're a woman, not because of your qualifications, which is famous sort of reproach. So the most visible problem for feminism probably is this lack of women in higher positions. But there are a lot of invisible, and we have a language to talk about it, which is liberalism. But there are a lot of invisible problems of dominance in our everyday practices, which are the conventions of speaking, of knowledge, and of the authority that knowledge supposes, of life goals that are being articulated. And I think that when we want to talk about the building of public life on an egalitarian basis with an eye to freedom for all, needs to address these difficult, almost invisible problems of dominance, and we need to develop a language. And I think that the language of liberalism is insufficient. We need the language of republicanism to be able to address this. Thank you very much.